Hello, it's been a while. Yeah, we have face cam. Right, first things first, I bought my Windows a while ago, so we're on a completely new install of Windows and everything. I've not actually managed to get the IDF build working in VS Code yet. I'm not quite sure what the issue is, but I've literally only spent a couple of minutes on it. But it is working in the command line, so we'll use that. Now, this video, we're not really going to achieve a lot. All we're going to do, particularly, is see where we got to last time, because it's been ages. See if everything's working. I've updated to IDF release 4.4, and I think we're on 4.3 in the last video, all those months ago. And I've just got a, I don't even know which one this is, to be honest. It's one I found lying about, an ESP, so we can test it and see what's going on. So having a quick look at the code, we're on which branch am I on? Let's have a quick look. Git bash. That's probably painfully small. But we're on the YouTube branch of the repo, anyway, at the head as of now when I'm recording this on Saturday the 5th. Okay, so let's just have a quick look at the code. Hopefully this will be useful looking through code that you're not familiar with. Certainly that's the case for me because I wrote it ages ago and I've not checked it since. Just to get a feel of what's going on. Fairly simple project anyway, so we should be winning on this, to be honest. So if we remember, the entry point for our code on an ESP is the function app main, which returns a void and takes a void, or doesn't return anything, to be slightly more correct. We've got a usual sort of startup stuff that you have to do, creating event loops, initializing the non-volatile flash and so on. And then I go, just the way I like to do it, even though I'm not an Arduino guy, have a nice setup function and then a loop in the while true, which it should be fairly familiar to Arduino-y type people. And that's just wrapped in a couple of macros, so if setup fails then it calls abort. That's literally all this does. In fact, the tooltip here should probably say that. It's even got likely unlikely macros, which are fairly pointless, to be honest. Error check failed function, yeah, probably just does a debug and then calls abort. Anyway, our setup, so what do? So we're initializing an LED, that's a good start. Now do, if we look in the header for main, do I say which pin that's on? GPIO 27. Is that the default GPIO for the onboard for the dev kits? We'll find out pretty soon. And true. Okay, that's not particularly helpful, Simon. What does true mean? Can I F12 into that? No, can I F12 into that? Yes. It's whether or not the pin's inverted. Okay, I could probably do with defining a structure for this. And then rather than passing in, I mean, GPIO number 27 is fairly obvious. But then for configuration parameters, you know, true, as you just saw then, what the hell does true mean? And IntelliSense isn't, or well, the tooltips aren't particularly helpful on that. So I might, yeah, in the future, we might change that to a structure, a config struct, where things are done by name, so it's a little bit easier on the eye to figure out what's going on. We can see we've got some Wi-Fi and we've got the simple network time protocol, so we can get real-world time from the Tinterwebs. Proves that Wi-Fi is working in the, well, proves that the internet is working through Wi-Fi. So we'll have to set that up. So we initialize the LED the LED, we initialize the Wi-Fi, we begin the Wi-Fi, then we do our SNCP initialization, and then in our main loop, we're just toggling, well, we do hello world, and then we just toggle the LED on and off. And in the background, SNCP should get time and things like that. So to get this to actually run, can I zoom this in? Oh, I can. Oh, look at that. Oh, we didn't like that. Ha, ruh-roh. Can I control C that, or have I completely balked it now? No, completely balked it. Brilliant. All right, close that. I'm going to have to manually kill the COM port. So let's do IDF. Let's do a CD into, have I still got this in my clipboard? No. So let's just do one of them. Okay, I don't dare zoom in again because it's, well, you saw what happened last time. So let's run this and see what happens. That sounds like a pretty good idea. So idf.py, we're on port COM6. Check that before, and we'll do a flash monitor. I think you can stack those if I remember correctly. Okay, connecting, that's a good start. Do I need to manually toggle the reboot? Oh, didn't like that. Fatal error detected. Was that me just spamming the buttons? There we go. Yeah, just spamming the phone. Let me just mute that. There we go. Okay, right, so that's flashing. Apologies that is so small on your screen. I'll try and fix that off stream. Let's just F11 that again. And let's do one of those. Oh, that's why that doesn't work. Never mind. Okay, right, so let's see what we did. Now, in the update to 4.4, when I tried to build this about 10 minutes ago, didn't build. The error, the compiler error it was giving me was that the bootloader binary was too big for the partition on the ESP. So I just went into menu config, had a look at the bootloader settings, and for some reason, I don't know why, but it's the compiler optimization has been changed from -os, which is for optimized for size, binary size, to optimize for performance at -02. I'm not entirely sure why, because the bootloader is not really doing a lot, so I don't see what benefit. There will be, because they've changed the default quite significantly there. So I don't know, we might look into it one day. I changed it back to -os and it compiled fine and fits. I don't really care about the bootloader, we're not going to be tinkering with that. So we see CPU frequency 160 megahertz, could bump that to 240 if I wanted. We've got some partitions, the heaps are initializing because it's a distributed heap across different sectors. GPIO setup was fine, the looks of it. Wi-Fi initialization, there's all the buffers and whatnot, that looks fine. IRAM optimizations are on, that's pretty good, we want that. We're in station mode, enable TSF, not a clue what that is, but fine. Station start, that's good, so that's our Wi-Fi begin. Smart. Oh, did I put smart config in on this? Oh, nice. So we can try that. So I've got smart config on my phone. So if I, how do I want to do this? Let's not do it that way. Now I've got a feeling I hard coded the password to my test router, Green Giant. Yes, I did. Okay. So if I do Green Giant, password on my phone, oh, this could be horrific. Will it focus? Will it be swans? There we go. And we're on the ESP Touch app there. Not used this in ages. Let's press connect, see what happens. Oh, that's just connecting my phone to the Wi-Fi of my test router. So here we go. Oh, did it connect? Is my router on? Yes, my router is on. Wait a minute. Connect a device, can't provide internet. Yeah, I don't care about that phone. Connect anyway. Oh god, I hate Android sometimes. Would you force it to stay connected? I don't care if it's not got in. Wait, why has it not got internet though? Anyway, irrelevant. One thing at a time. Let's just get connected to the Wi-Fi. Oh, there we go. It's popped up on ESP Touch. I need to do a screen capture for this. So we see Green Giant test. So I'll key in the password, which was Green Giant. Green Giant. Hopefully you can see that on the ESP Touch app. And let's press confirm. See if we get any debug. ESP Touch is configuring. I've got a feeling this is going to shit itself, but we'll see. Right, I remember when I did smart config a couple of years ago, this worked. In fact, it wasn't even that long ago. This worked pretty flawlessly once I'd figured out that your router needs to be in legacy mode. Was it Green Giant or was it Green Ant Giant? No, Green Giant. Still, I'm just on a... you can't see that. ESP Touch is configuring, please wait a moment. Okay, I've got fed up of that. Can I try again? Can you do the things? What if I reboot? Why is reboot not working? Enable. Pressing the enable button. Why are you not rebooting? That's interesting, is the IDF crashed? Okay, just hit Control C, that did something. Oh right, okay, reboot's working though. Oh, so that's fine channel. Oh, hang on, no, that's correct. That's what we want. Wi-Fi enable sniffer, that's also what we want because of the way smart config works. It's a little bit of a bastardization of the Wi-Fi protocol. Clever, but a little bit naughty. So why is this not... I've got a feeling it's my phone. Can I just turn off 3G? Connected to device, can't provide internet. Yeah, I couldn't give a monkeys about internet. Shush, Android. I own you. There we go. Right, okay, so smart config's doing its thing now. We'll go through this. I'll show you how it works because it's really, really cool. And quite interesting when you're a turbo nerd. Right, okay, so we've got into our main loop now. If I hold this up, hopefully it doesn't reboot. We've got no blinking lights in. We've also got no focus, but thankfully that doesn't really matter for a blinky light. So we'll have a look at the pinout on that in a sec. Okay, so let's have a look at what smart config did, because I don't recall going through this on a video. Again, it was so long ago. So what smart config does is it... What's the best way of explaining this? When Wi-Fi advertises itself, similar sort of way to Bluetooth actually, it just pumps out a packet of data. It just broadcasts it over 2.4 gigs. And so it says things like, you know, who I am, my capabilities. It's not a very big packet at all. But it just spans the frequency with it slowly, and you know, at a sensible duty cycle. So if you've got loads of these going on, it doesn't just, you know, jam everything. But what the smart config does is it hijacks that packet. It's not really the terminology I want to use, but anyway, and it embeds within that packet information. In this case, the SSID and password, and actually the MAC address of the router, I think, goes in there as well. So your phone is then pushing out this random information that no one's going to understand. But the ESP smart config sniffs that, it listens to it, wouldn't normally listen to it, it's not a router, so why would it listen to the advertising of a end device? But the smart config listens to that and goes, aha, this is one of our sneaky, sneaky packets. Extracts the data out of it. So you can see words like sniffer and things like that. And you can see individual characters coming in here. This is hard to read, but you can sort of see green, giant, bit of noise in there as well, and some missed packets and whatever. But it actually got the SSID at this point. We missed a bunch of packets before here in the log, but whatever it is, what it is. We got it again, actually. We got the password down here, and then we got the SSID again, and the MAC address. And now at this point, it's actually sniffed all the data it needs. So we've got the MAC address, we've got the password, we've got the SSID. So we've sniffed that from my phone advertising this information completely publicly. Something to be cognizant of if you're doing this, you know, in a public area. And also why I'm doing this on a test router that I will turn off once I finish recording the video. But that's entirely up to you how you want to do things. Now this passes it then through. Now do I actually save that to my non-volatile? Let's have a look. So event handler, it's not going to be that one because I think I've got smart config event handler. Yes I do, smart config event handler. So switch event got SSID and password. So this will fire once that happens. And actually we can see event handler event ID 2, I bet that's 2. Yes it is, that enum is 2 there. So that's this log message here, event ID percent %d being the enum, and that is what we see, whoop, here, event ID, and then the enum value is 2, which means we're going to enter this case. So we do a mem copy. Got a bit of bounds checking in there because it's going into an array, not a heap pointer. That's good. Do I actually save that to non-volatile though? I don't think I do. No, I don't think I do. And then we call Wi-Fi connect. Okay. So that's pretty good. So then we get Wi-Fi event handler ID 4. So Wi-Fi event handler ID 4, which is station connected. That's good. So that means it connected to the router. Doesn't necessarily mean it got an IP address. Then we get IP event handler ID 0. So we can have a look for that. IP event handler ID 0, which happens to be got an IP address. Got IP, blah blah blah. Got IP, waiting for a mutex, connected. Smart config then crapped itself, don't know why. Don't particularly care at this point because we're connected. And then we're toggling this LED. Okay, so two things not working at the moment. One of them is we can see here that we're just getting tick. Oh no, that's time. Wait a minute, it is 11:53 at the moment as I'm recording this. Let's just pause that. can we see where time change? Yes, so that's ticks or milliseconds since boot or something like that anyway. Then it flicks over to using real world time, but the NTP is crap, so it hasn't actually got an NTP update yet. So it's starting at 00. I wonder if there's a way of changing that for log messages. So don't flick from ticks to real world time until you've had an SNCP update. Anyway, and then it flicks over to 11:48, and you can probably see down in the corner here, that's actually quite correct. So wait, so it did actually get internet. So my router is set up correctly still. So I've not had that turned on since the last video either. So the only thing not working is the LED blinky, and that's most likely because I've changed dev board. I tidied my desk. Oh yeah, I know, why does anyone do that? So I don't know where the ESP went that I was using for this project. Anyway, what is this? Is this a dev kit C? Doesn't say on it, so it's probably some knockoff. But let's assume it is a dev kit C. So if we go to here, ESP32 dev kit C. Let's do an images. And let's do one of them. Can I has resolution? Yes, I can. Have they finally put this on the website? Oh, oh, you beauties. You know what? LED. Where am I, Adair? LED. Rip. I'm sure there is a second LED. Yeah, I can see it. What pin it's on? Oh, this isn't the dev kit C. Oh, don't make me bleep this out. Have I got a multimeter handy? Or could I just... Hang on a sec. ESP32 dev kit LED pin GPIO. LED supports, yeah, I don't care. Onboard LED GPIO 23. GPIO 2. Ah, that looks good. Sorry, I'm on the wrong screen. Force of habit. So that looks like this. Of course, that that doesn't necessarily mean anything. So GPIO2, let's give it a go. I've got a feeling when we did this last, we actually had an external LED. But anyway, let's change that over to GPIO2. Let's do a save. Let's do a control bracket out of that and do a flash monitor. And see if we get dust blinking lights in. Why do I have to manually... I don't know why the enable reset circuit thing's not working on that dev board, but anyway, it is what it is. So that's uploading now. We'll watch this live on webcam. It's going to make me do smart config again because I haven't saved it. And clearly that's still running on my phone, which is a little spooky. So I definitely closed the app. Oh well, whatever. Oh, we have dust blinking lights in. There we go. So it works. God, I need to sort the focus out on that webcam. Oh, there we go. I know you can do the trick of... Yeah, the problem is in OBS I've cropped this image quite significantly. Focus, damn you. I'm going to get a good look at this. Will it work? Will it work? No, it won't. Anyway, you get the idea. It's a blinking light. Okay, so that's working. Not a huge surprise, because I feel like we left it in a working state. We've got time and everything coming through, so it's doing internets, which is nice. Unless I have a local NTP server. Let's just have a quick look at that. Which servers have I configured SNTP to use? Interesting, I've changed my coding style a little bit since I wrote this. Not significantly, but just based on new best practices and so on. Do I have an array of... time.google, pool NTP. Why do I prioritize Google? But I'm not using a local one here. I think if you set your servers, it won't use a local one. Not sure, but I think so. Okay, so that works. So that's going to be it for this video. I just wanted to whet the appetite again. Tell you, I am still here. Got a new career as well. Well, a new job, should I say. Funnily enough, working on an ESP-32. For a pretty cool bit of kit. Can I show you that? All the noises. That's what it looks like on the outside. I even focused on that. It's a wearable device, connects to various sensors and stuff aimed at things like the construction industry, so you can have high-vis jackets. Oh, it's in the other room. That's got flashing LEDs on it and will flash red if there's some sort of problem. So perhaps you've exceeded your decibel limit for your hearing, or the person has fallen, and they will notify each other. So if someone else has fallen nearby, it will alert you. It also alerts the operator through the cloud and all the various good sort of things. It's gas sensors, so for toxic and flammable gases. What else does it do? GPS and things like that. There's a proximity warning thing, so it can tell you if you've had a car crash or you're about to have a car crash or things like that. It does all sorts of stuff. It's really cool. I should probably take you through it at some point. Double check with work that they're happy me doing that, but I don't see why they wouldn't. But it's an ESP inside. It's actually a Rover. I think it's a Rover module inside, so I can show you that someday. But yeah, that's it. Whet the appetite, I'm still here. If you do have any ideas or suggestions of what you would like to see me do, then please do put them down in the usual comments below. Thank you for all the subs, by the way, that I've had, also been off, as it were. I did want to delay making new videos until they release IDF version 5, because I really, really want to do C++ 20 and learn it with you guys. I know a good amount about it, but I've never actually used it yet. And it is coming in IDF version 5, which is going to be, obviously it's a big change because it's a huge core language change for a start, C++ 20. But also it will necessitating a huge IDF change, improvements of course. So we'll do that at some point. Maybe even if it's worth doing and I can wrap my head around how to do it, use the experimental branches of IDF version 5, so the pre-release and so on, so we can start playing with it ahead of time, maybe. Depends what sort of working state it's in, to be honest. But yeah, that will be for the future. This project will continue now. I have got, and I think I showed you in the last video, a new dev board that's got some various different sensors on it, a common sort of like a temperature sensor, light dependent resistor. I think it's got a few different LEDs and buttons and things like that. once I remember where I've put it, we'll flick over to using that and start writing things like drivers. We've done a very simple driver for the GPIO, for the LEDs and so on. I have done a non-volatile store as well. So we need to actually integrate this into our Wi-Fi, I think, so it doesn't boot up into smart config if it's actually got history or it knows of a Wi-Fi. And then of course we need a fallback in case, you know, that changes, or we want to manually say no, forget what you know, I've changed my router or whatever. So I think of a cunning way of doing that. But yeah, that's it. I'm waffling. See you in the next one.